Hey everybody, I'm Peter Harris. I'm a venture capitalist, been doing this now for about 14 years, done over 60 deals, trained hundreds of students on how to do venture capital investing. Today, we're gonna do a React video on Shark Tank. This one is the founders of LovePop cards. They're super cool cards. When you open them up, it turns into a pop-up 3D piece of art, super fun. I actually have a few and have given a few over the years, and so I'm excited to hear their pitch and see what the sharks say and give my thoughts on how I would evaluate it as a venture capitalist.
I'm Wambi.
And I'm John.
And we're from Boston, Massachusetts.
I think this should be more of a pirate red.
John and I met 10 years ago in college studying ship design, naval architecture, and marine engineering.
We reconnected at Harvard Business School a few years later and decided to pursue a business idea together.
I think we got it. Let's get it in the computer.
We use our background in ship design to create a unique twist to an existing product.
We're using the same software, we're using the same 3D thinking that can help people create meaningful connections.
All right, so some things that I like right off the bat. So they've got kind of a technical background. They went to Harvard Business School, which look like it, just because you go to Harvard doesn't mean you're going to be a successful entrepreneur, but the likelihood that you're probably smart, driven, hardworking is probably a lot higher than the typical student that goes to other schools. So like already, like there's some good signaling here. And then the fact that they basically said, you know what? We are so passionate about this. We have so much conviction that we're going to give up like really high paying jobs and really go after this and invest our own money. Like, I love that passion because like clearly like they're willing to take the risk. And as an investor, like I love that. Like, I want to be right alongside them risking capital and trying to build something big. So anyways, so far, really like the founders and kind of their motivations, which I think is a big part of picking good entrepreneurs to back. But they've never built something before, so we'll see. We'll see how they do.
Hi, I'm John, and this is my partner, Wambi, and we're the creators of LovePop. And we're here today to offer you 10% of our company for $300,000.
All right, so they're selling 10% for 300 grand. That puts the value of the business at $3 million.
You are searching for a birthday card. You're going through that rack of thoughtless, uninspired cards, doing that multiple choice selection process, and you end up with something that's okay. Don't settle anymore. Come to LovePop, where we create intricate paper art that pops, just like this. In today's digital and distracting world, things might be becoming more impersonal. But a love pop is unique because it's unexpected. It's tangible. The reaction we've gotten has been so positive and so emotional that we realize we're tapping into something much bigger, the human need to connect. So sharks, help us spread the love.
All right, so first of all, granted, I'm biased because I've bought several of their products, but I actually, at my office, have one of their products, and I have it left out like on one of my shelves because I just think it's really cool. And then I also got one for my business partner, and he has it on his shelf, and it's like this really cool motorcycle because he's like way into motorcycles and stuff. So like I think they're onto something. Like, it's totally unique, it's really fun, it's the kind of thing that you keep, right? Like, how often are you really keeping cards that you receive? So I love that. The other part of it, though, is like, how often are people buying cards these days? I don't know. I feel like that happens less and less, right? Like, now we send emails and texts and, you know, gifts and those sort of things. So I don't know. Like, I feel like the overall, I'd be curious to do the research and see, but it wouldn't surprise me if overall, like, cards are declining as a market. But if you're going to do it and you're going to play in the space, having something super unique, like what they're doing, I think is super important. Now, I don't know if they're going to bring it up, but just because you're unique doesn't mean that you have anything proprietary. So I'll be curious, like, how do they deal with competitors? Like, do they have patents on this? Anything that can protect them? Because otherwise, like, I could see some of the bigger players coming in and commoditizing this, like, really quickly, right? Like, you could go into Alibaba and find competing products like this pretty easily, so.
Look how intricate it is.
So tell us about the business model. Are you handcrafting each of these?
Are you online selling them or at stores?
Yeah, so let's break it apart into two questions. So the one is, what's the business model? How are we selling these? And one is, how do we manufacture
them? That's a good idea, Wambi.
I love how you're controlling the sharks.
So we'll start with the first one, which is how do we sell them? So we have 4 kiosks in Boston. So
in Boston?
In Boston, that's
right. Where are they? That's hometown.
Exactly. So our strategy is kiosks, and that's where we meet the customer. That's where they have the experience opening the cards, what you just experienced. Then those customers come online into the LovePop ecosystem where we offer additional services like send a surprise, where we'll actually handwrite a note in the card and mail it.
Okay, what does that cost?
$8 to $13 a card. Ooh. And if you choose the send a surprise option, it's $5 more.
John, you just graduated 3 weeks ago. How long have you been running the business?
So it's been a year and a half entirely while in school.
And what are your sales in that year and a half?
$300,000.
But if it's an artisan business and you guys are Harvard grads, did you ever test price sensitivity? Because why wouldn't this, this is absolutely stunning.
Yeah, why wouldn't it be $129?
Why isn't it's a piece of art. Why isn't it $99?
We want this to be an accessible.
But you want to make money, right?
That's true, but we do make money right now. We laser cut these cards. We design them in a computer, literally the same software that I use to design ships.
Let's say I sent you 3,000 orders a month. How would you produce them?
We actually open our own production facility overseas. We produce 20,000 cards a month right now, and we're scaling that up.
And how many different designs?
We have about 100 different designs right now.
All right, so let's talk. There's a lot to unpack there. So first of all, their strategy is they have these kiosks and then they have their online strategy. The kiosks make sense because this is a very like tangible, get your hands on type product to really get the full customer experience. The flip side is kiosks can be really challenging, especially because, you know, you've got the land, the rent, the actual kiosk itself, the labor, and then you got to manage all of it, right? So pretty hard to scale. Some companies have done it fairly effectively. So Skull Candy, for example, is a good example of that, where like they had kiosks in a lot of malls and high density walking areas. But ultimately they actually moved away from the kiosks, I think largely because it was hard to generate the profits that would make it work, and it just wasn't scalable. But it was a good way to like launch the brand and get people knowing about it, which could be kind of their thought process as well. So far, they've done 300,000 in revenue over the last year and a half. Let's just say like most of that occurred in the last 12 months. So basically, they're asking for 10 times for the value of the business, right? 300 million divided by 300 grand. I'll tell you right now, like 10 times for a consumer products business, especially one that doesn't have any sort of subscription tied to it, feels really high. You might be able to get away with that if their margins are really high, but I'd be curious to see what it costs them. They're charging somewhere between $8 and $13 per card. Now they are laser cutting them and they are having them manufactured overseas. So, you know, that's probably getting them in at like $1 to $2 per card would be my guess. So total like gross margin on this business is somewhere probably in like the 70 to 90% range, which is really, really good. But the flip side is they've got to run all these kiosks. And so their operating expenses, I would imagine, and their marketing expenses are probably really high because they're operating in a very competitive market. And then they have their kiosks, which are high cost as well. So they kind of need that high margin.
Let's take a single kiosk and extrapolate over a 12-month working period. What do you think the revenue will be?
So it'll be about $240,000.
Per kiosk?
Per kiosk.
What will be the profit on that?
It's going to be about $40,000.
And what percentage of a kiosk person goes to the website and buys more product?
So we tested this for a month and a half, and we had 34 people come online and buy.
That's not a lot,
yeah,
actually.
No.
Yeah, we believe in the kiosk model.
All right, so... Here they're hitting on the same things that I was just talking about, right? Like this is the challenge of the kiosk model. So they're assuming or projecting that they'll make 240K per kiosk, which they've only been around a year and a half. So that's, you know, they only have a handful of kiosks. So this is not like statistically significant. So I would like take it with a big grain of salt. But even so, I mean, you're talking about 16% margins. And when they say profits, like I'm assuming they're talking about contribution margins. So they're not covering like their own salaries. They're not covering any of the overhead of the overall business, any of those kinds of things. And 16% gross margin is really small. And that's why their question was immediately like, well, how many people are coming back? 34 is not enough information to know, but it does feel really small, because if I've got a kiosk, that means that's doing 240K in revenue annually, and we just give them the benefit of the doubt and say that the average card is $10. That means that the average kiosk is selling 24,000 cards, and you only get 34 that come back and buy again. Like, that is horrible. That is terrible. You would want this to be somewhere at least closer to, I don't know, like 10%, because at 10%, that's 2,400 people coming back. Now, I've also got like big questions on whether or not they're really selling 24,000 cards per kiosk. Like, that's crazy. Like, 24,000 kiosks means that they're selling 65 cards per day. And if you assume, like, I don't know, maybe a 10-hour day, I mean, like, that's 6 cards per hour. I mean, I guess that's doable, but that feels like you are just constantly, like, every 10 minutes, you are selling a card, right? It means you got to have, like, high flow through that area, and that's not going to be the case all day long every day. You're going to have, like, peak times, and so you're going to have to staff up for those times, right, to run that many transactions. I don't know. I feel like their assumptions are super aggressive, and then they're not seeing a lot of flow through to acquiring the customer, which is the whole point of doing the kiosk, right? If you're going to suffer 16% gross margins or contribution margins, you are only really want to do that if you can get them to come back and buy more cards. But it seems like that's really challenging. My guess, though, is that part of the reason for that is that people just don't buy cards that often, right? I buy cards like maybe a couple times a year. So I might see the kiosk, really like it, really enjoy it. And next year I buy a card, I may or may not buy a LovePop card. I might decide that I need to buy a different style of card, which could really hurt them. I might not buy another LovePop card for another couple years, right? Which means you gotta finance like your business long enough for that customer to finally come back after a couple years, which I think is challenging.
Kiosk model as a marketing vehicle.
Why?
Because it's profitable. So we are attracting customers profitably, and our focus is on building the brand and then taking that community online.
But the problem is that they're not getting people online, right? They're getting the word out there, but no one's converting.
So what is the capital cost for each kiosk?
It takes around $20,000 flat to open a kiosk.
Can I tell you what I don't like about your business, quite honestly?
Yep.
$20,000 to open a kiosk, right? So like right off the bat, you've got to now go out and sell 2,000 cards just to make up for setting up one kiosk, let alone like the labor, let alone the inventory, let alone like all the other expenses just to set it up, right? You're already like pretty far in the hole.
All excited. I thought, oh, maybe this is my next cousin's Maine Lobsters. Two guys running a shop are pretty happy making $200,000 a month on one truck. But the difference between you and them is they're not fancy, and I kind of like that. They wanted to get everything perfectly in order before they even bought their second company truck. The cards, they're nice, but I've seen pop-up cards in every fancy store I've gone to. What's the difference there? Your little kiosk idea, it's a smart idea. But I'm telling you, it's too much, too fast, too fancy that I mistrust it. And I've invested in businesses like that, and I always lose my shirt. So sadly, I'm out.
Yeah, so think about the things that she said, right? Like, she kind of likes them, but this kiosk model is just really challenging. And in order for this to really work, you got to grow really fast. You got to get these out there. And that's just going to cost a lot of money. And she's kind of agreeing with a lot of the things that I've been talking about.
Yeah, thank you.
I think that they're beautiful, beautiful cards. And I think that people will love it, but I can't see your valuation right now. $300,000 for 10%.
Yeah, what I say earlier, 10%, that's 10 times, right? They're probably at least 2 to 4 times more expensive than the market would pay.
So, I'm out.
Now, okay, so she could have offered a lower valuation. I think, honestly, and this definitely happens in venture capital investing, is the entrepreneur or the investor like looks at the deal and they don't really love it. And they use a scapegoat. So in this case, she's using valuation as a scapegoat to say she's out. When in reality, like if she really loved it, she could have just offered a lower valuation, right? So.
I have a lot of businesses that are in this space online that are involved around marriage and engagement and times when people emotionally are willing to spend a lot on artisan items like this.
Let me show you something because I think you'll find it interesting. For your wedding customers.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
That's pretty.
It's spectacular. And I have so many customers that would buy this. And the thing that I love about those customers, they don't care what it costs. What is the price of this at 100 at a time?
So we've sold those packages for between $2,000 and $3,000.
For how many?
100 to 200.
And our minimums are actually pretty low.
Guys, the way I understand your motto is it's a get wide as opposed to get tall model, where you want to get as many locations as you can. But malls with traffic, those rents are going up. And those kiosk spaces are going to get more and more expensive. I think you can do it. I just don't think you can be big enough because of the risk within the real estate industry. So for those reasons, I'm out.
Thank you, Mike.
I'm telling you, it's all about these kiosks. They're cool, but they're killing the business. And even Mr. Wonderful's excited about it, not through the kiosk, but through the other businesses that he could bring them into.
I see that you guys have a fanatical culture around service and your customers. Execution is a little bit questionable because you haven't done enough of it on scale. But I'll make you an offer. $300,000 for 20%.
So he's offering $1.5 million valuation, which, like I said,
I don't think it's big enough.
I think it's a little high, Kevin. But
I'll make the same offer exactly. No partner. And I bring a pretty big database. I think I can bring a lot of customers to you.
What are you going to do?
I'll tell you what I would do. I would probably take Mr. Wonderful's offer because I think he does probably have a lot of businesses that he could just push this through. And at this point, like, their challenge, the reason they're doing the kiosk is they need to build the brand. Right? Like Barbara said, there's a lot of other competitors out there that are doing somewhat similar things. And so, like, the only way that you ultimately compete is you build this brand where, like, people, when they think about pop-up cards, they think of you and they come to you, right? And so what they need to do is they need to figure out how do you get this out to as many people as possible and build that brand and give those customers that experience. And it feels like Mr. Wonderful can probably do that a little bit better than the other shark.
First, thank you very much for those offers. We do believe that our valuation is fair at $3 million. You've offered us a $1.5 million valuation.
All right, Wambi, I'll meet you in the middle. $300,000 for 15%.
I'll make the same offer.
Well, there you go again. Now,
I just see too much synergy with my other companies in this space.
Well, I see the retail presence. I love the idea of the kiosk model. You got to build out the customers, they'll get you the brand.
And by the way, I'm in Boston, so just throwing that in there.
By the way, I was just on a cruise in Boston. Who cares?
Thank you both for your offers. We are really excited to make a deal with Mr. Wonderful.
So I think this is actually the right move because I think the retail strategy is really challenging. And think about this, this was shot, I think this all occurred pre-COVID. So imagine like the impact of COVID if you had a ton of retail or a bunch of kiosks out there. I mean, it would have killed it. The reality is everything is moving online, so I think this was the right call.
Value that Mr. Wonderful is going to bring. He's a phenomenal business mind, and he understands a wedding business, which is a big potential opportunity for us.
Interesting outcome. Honestly, I didn't think they were going to get a deal because I honestly think this is a really tough business. But I can see where Mr. Wonderful came from in that he feels like, hey, I can kick in some money, and I can immediately plug them in, and I can generate like really interesting revenues. And probably make my money back just on the profits of the co-sell agreements through my other businesses right away. So honestly, like, I was a little bit surprised that they got a deal done, but it makes sense that the deal that they did get done was the one with Mr. Wonderful and the way they approached it. So anyways, thanks for joining me. If you enjoyed this one and want to watch another one, Come join me as we review Signal Vault.